When you learn physics, you begin with the basics and build on them. Eventually, you find that you've moved beyond the basics and no longer can recognize where you came from. In this video, I want to talk about one of the first topics one learns in an introductory physics class, kinetic energy, and how it eventually seems unrecognizable. Let's see where that takes us. Before we start, I'm obligated by contract to warn you that this video is way more mathy than most. It's not dreadful, but if you're a math phobe, you might have nightmares, so viewer discretion is advised. No plus or equal signs were harmed in the production of this video. However, in the spirit of full disclosure, a square root pulled a muscle, but it's expected to make a full recovery, so it's all good. The idea of kinetic energy originates from the era of Newton, although Newton himself wasn't a fan. Indeed, it took several decades before physicists could even agree on what kinetic energy was. But that's all history, and there's no longer any debate on the topic. Kinetic energy is the energy of motion. That motion could be moving, like an arrow in flight, or it could be rotation or vibration. However, I want to talk just about simple translational motion. The equation for kinetic energy is mathematically straightforward. If you have a mass m moving at a velocity v, kinetic energy is simply 1/2 times the mass times the velocity squared. Ke equals 1/2 mv squared. And you can use that equation to solve all sorts of introductory physics problems. It's a great tool, and it served scientists well from the early 1700s until about 1905, when this troublemaker spoke up. Einstein was interested in the laws of physics when things traveled at near the speed of light. He came up with an equation not for kinetic energy, but for the entire energy of the object. I bet you're thinking that I meant this equation, E equals mc squared, because, well, duh, Einstein, and that's his equation. But no, I didn't mean that one. That's because Einstein's famous equation is a special case and one that only applies to an object at rest. E equals mc squared is for an object that isn't moving. It's the energy associated with the stationary mass of the object. Now, if you want to use Einstein's physics to talk about a moving object, you need to use a slightly different equation. For a moving object, Einstein found that energy is equal to a thing called gamma times mc squared. Gamma is equal to 1 over the square root of 1 minus the velocity of the object squared divided by the speed of light squared. Now, I haven't derived this equation, nor have I motivated where that gamma comes from. I did that in several earlier videos, and I put links to a playlist of all of them down there in the description. They're great fun, but they're a diversion from the point of this video. For this video, just take it as a given. The equation E of a moving object is simply gamma mc squared. Now, notice that I said that this is the total energy, not the kinetic energy. The total energy of a body that isn't acting under a force is equal to the kinetic energy plus the mass energy. So we can do some simple math. We find that, at least according to Einstein, the kinetic energy of an object would be the quantity gamma minus 1 times mc squared. I guess the first thing to do is to see if Einstein's formula for kinetic energy and the classical formula look the same. I've plotted both of them here. We see that they disagree for velocities that are a large fraction of the speed of light. However, as we look at lower speeds, say under 10% the speed of light, the two graphs look pretty much the same. This means that the equations are numerically the same at low speeds. And it's important to remember that 10% the speed of light is just slightly slower than going around the Earth once in a single second. So, this means that the classical formula for kinetic energy is pretty good for any reasonable speed you might encounter. Of course, what I've shown you here is simply a graph of both ways to calculate kinetic energy. How about showing how one can get from Einstein's equation to the classical equation? How do you do that? Well, for this, we need to use some mathematical tricks, specifically one called the binomial expansion. This mathematical equation was discovered in about 1655 by Isaac Newton, although it wasn't formally proved until 1736 by mathematician John Colson, who held the same Lucasian chair of mathematics at the University of Cambridge that Isaac Newton held before him. The binomial expansion says that the expression 1 plus x raised to the n power can be written as an infinite sum of the form 1 plus n times x plus n times n minus 1 times x squared divided by 2 factorial plus n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 times x cubed divided by 3 factorial, and so on. This equation works for any n and for all x's that are between minus 1 and plus 1. If you want to work out the derivation, well, that's up to you, but that's how it goes. So we can look at that gamma factor of Einstein and see how this binomial expansion can help us. 1 over the square root of 1 minus v squared over c squared can be written as 1 minus v squared divided by c squared to the minus 1/2 power. So, since v divided by c is less than 1, that means that v squared divided by c squared is definitely less than 1. And this means that we can use the binomial expansion. We plop in minus 1/2 for n and minus v squared over c squared for x, and we do some simplification, and we end up with the final answer. This is for gamma. Now remember that gamma times mc squared is the total energy. So we multiply this series of terms with the mc squared, and we get this expression for energy, which is mc squared plus 1/2 mv squared plus 3/8 mv to the fourth divided by c squared, and so on. Remember that, in relativity, energy is the rest mass energy plus the kinetic energy, and that's what we see here. The mc squared is the rest mass energy, and the rest is the kinetic energy. Thus, to find the kinetic energy, we subtract off the mc squared, and we're left with just kinetic energy. And, as we expected, it starts out with the 1/2 mv squared, and it has some other terms. So now you might ask yourself, just how big of a deal are these extra terms? We can kind of get a sense of that by asking at what velocity the second term is big enough to change the kinetic energy by a 1% difference from what you get from the classical 1/2 mv squared. When you do that, you find that you're going to have to be going at about 12% the speed of light, which is about 22,000 miles per second, or about 35,000 kilometers per second. Ballpark, that's about fast enough to circle the globe once in a single second. Given that the fastest object made by mankind is the Parker Solar Probe, which travels at a speed of about 7 miles per second, or just over 11 kilometers per second, we see why physics professors only teach the classical equation for kinetic energy, which, I remind you, is 1/2 mv squared. So that's the deal. Classical physics applies for all reasonable speeds that you will encounter, while Einstein's equation works for all speeds, from zero motion up to the speed of light. And furthermore, we've worked out how the math of how one can connect the two. It's cool how things all hang together. It's almost like that Einstein guy was smart or something. Okay, what did you think? Lots of math to be sure, but why not? I mean, math is the best language for precise physics, no? If you enjoyed the video, please like, subscribe, and share. And let us know in the comments section if you want more or less math-centric videos, and we'll take the suggestions into consideration. In the meantime, sit back and marvel at this wonderful result, which, once again, reminds us that physics is everything.